Hello and welcome to another edition of Currently in Quincy. I'm Joe Catalano, and on today's program we will learn about an event coming up to provide beds for those children who are less fortunate in our area, from A Bed for Every Child. First, though, we check out the weather in the news for you this morning. Currently in Quincy, partly sunny, kind of breezy out there. It's 70 degrees right now. It'll climb into the mid-70s this afternoon with a mix of sun and clouds. Pretty nice night this evening. Clear skies, lows in the lower 60s, sets the stage for an absolutely sparkling Saturday. Tomorrow, definitely the pick of the weekend, with abundant sunshine, warm breezes, low humidity, and temperatures right around 81 degrees. It'll be a great night tomorrow night for Quincy's Flag Day Parade. Temperatures will drop off into the mid-60s. Look out for a spot shower, maybe a thunderstorm on Father's Day for Sunday with highs into the mid-70s. Still a little unsettled here on Monday, too, with showers, maybe a thunderstorm, and highs Monday into the mid-70s. Right now, again, partly sunny, breezy, 70 degrees in Quincy. In the news today, City of Quincy is vowing to appeal a recent approval of a state permit for the construction of a new Long Island Bridge. The Department of Environmental Protection recently okayed the City of Boston's request for a permit to replace the bridge that was demolished back in 2015 after it was deemed unsafe. Boston wants to rebuild the bridge and open up a substance abuse treatment center on Long Island, but Quincy is fighting the plan, arguing that a new bridge would create major traffic congestion in Squantum and North Quincy. Quincy is urging Boston to develop a ferry service to Long Island instead. Boston still needs several more permits before the bridge can be rebuilt. Quincy officials are vowing to fight the project with all available resources. Well, there's a brand new firefighters memorial statue at Mount Wollaston Cemetery here in Quincy. The new bronze statue was officially dedicated during the 90th annual Firefighters Memorial Sunday service this past Sunday. Mayor Thomas Koch praised all firefighters for their dedication to keeping the people of Quincy safe.
You know, this cemetery, which was consecrated in 1855, people come from all over to visit the cemetery to look at the beautiful monuments, truly artwork throughout this place. The history of the city as a granite capital, and this is also one of those great pieces. If you just look at the base of this, it's a piece of work of art in itself. And of course, with the beautiful new bronze statue on top of it, it's a great visible sign to everybody that passes by here of the service the men of Quincy have given to this great city. In a very real way, we remember those that have gone before us. And in the light of D-Day anniversary recently, firefighters over the years, many of them have been veterans. Many have been called to serve and have served so well with great dedication and fidelity.
Now, the new monument was modeled after the original 90-year-old concrete statue, which was in poor condition. It has since been moved to the front of fire headquarters over on Quincy Avenue, where it will receive some repairs. Members of Firefighters Local 792 raised $30,000 for the new memorial, which is dedicated to all Quincy firefighters who have died and to all firefighters. A known Quincy drug dealer is facing some new charges. 40-year-old Christopher Colley is facing new charges of trafficking in cocaine. Police acting on a tip from Boston police arrested Colley after he allegedly sold drugs on Washington Street in Quincy Point recently. A drug-sniffing dog reportedly located drugs on Colley. Officers later seized over $6,000 in cash at Colley's South Street home. Quincy police asking for your help in locating a bike thief. A man was captured on home surveillance video stealing a bicycle from in front of a house on Baxter Street in Quincy Point this past Wednesday evening. Now, police say the suspect appears to be a younger white male with a tattoo on his right arm. He stole a black Schwinn mountain bike with some red detailing on the side. Anybody with information is asked to call Quincy Police Detectives at 617-745-5764. Well, it was Quincy police to the rescue when a man lost his prosthetic leg while he was tying up his boat. at the Bay Point Marina in Quincy Points recently. Now, police say the man fell into the water last Saturday evening and lost his prosthetic leg and his cell phone. The police department's marine unit used their remote-controlled underwater search vehicle to locate the leg and the man's iPhone, which was reportedly still working. That leg is said to be valued at anywhere from $25,000 to $80,000. Now that you are up to date with weather and news, let's check out our programming lineup for later on today here on Quincy Access Television. Starts with a replay of this program currently in Quincy today at 5 o'clock. Then at 5:30, get some sound advice from attorney Tom Williams.
Hello, folks. I'm attorney Tom Williams, and welcome to Sound Advice.
This year's North Quincy High School graduation ceremony tonight at 6 p.m. 7:30, looks like we have our Quincy High School graduation ceremony for you. And it's the Forgotten People tonight at 10 p.m. Check out Channel 9 every day. You'll learn about Quincy City Department's different committee activities. Starts at 5:30 with Quincy in Focus. Media advisory at 6, the Complete Streets program. New FYI from the Quincy Health Department at 6:30. The topic tonight is skin cancer. State View at 7 o'clock, State Senator John Keenan speaking about the new state budgets. On Cue. This is Quincy High School's community magazine show, tonight at 7:30 on Channel 9. AM Quincy at 8 o'clock, an update on this week's Board of License Commissioners meeting.
And this is my show.
The Kent Clasby Show, episode 2 at 8:30 tonight.
Thomas F. Clasby.
Then at 9 o'clock, find out what's happening at your library for the month of June.
Welcome to At Your Library.
Get a complete program schedule over on our website, which is qatv.org. When you get there, click on Program Schedule. Don't forget, too, you can always like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and check out our weekly ad in the Quincy Sun. Coming up, we take a look at a few of the current events and activities that are being featured on our electronic bulletin board on Channel 8 for your information. Please stay with us. We're back with you in just 1 minute. Welcome back. Here is a check of some of the current events and activities that are featured right now on our electronic bulletin board on Channel 8 for your information. Of course, tomorrow it's the 68th annual Flag Day celebration here in Quincy. Parade will step off on Hancock Street in Quincy Center at 7 o'clock and make its way down Marymount Parkway to Pageant Field for a flag-raising ceremony. And then the fireworks display after that. You can watch the parade live right here on Quincy Access Television beginning at 7:15 tomorrow night. The Schiller Boston Community Chorus will present a free classical music concert called Songs of a New World. This is tomorrow at 3 o'clock at Christ Church on Quincy Avenue. Text MUSIC to 617-396-3199 or visit schillerbostoninstitute.com/Boston Chorus for more information. Tomorrow is also the 28th annual Walk for Hospice of the South Shore. It's from 7 to 10 a.m. at Weymouth High School this year. You should visit southshorehealth.org/walk for all the details. And the Adams National Historical Park in Quincy presents Father's Day with John Adams on Sunday. John Adams actor Michael LePage will be sharing his experiences as a founding father and as a father during the American Revolution. Call 617-770-1175 to learn more. And if you have an event or an activity you'd like to promote, visit our website, qatv.org. Just download a bulletin board request form, fill it out, and send it in. We'll put your message up here on Channel 8, too. Coming up, we learned about an event coming up next week to make sure that every child has a bed to sleep in. That's next. Welcome back. There is an organization called A Bed for Every Child, and is coming to Quincy next Saturday to the Quincy Credit Union to make sure that youngsters here on the South Shore have a bed to sleep in at night. You wouldn't think it's an issue or a problem, but it is. And we're welcoming to the program this morning Tina Baptista and Amy Kelly to give us all the details. So ladies, welcome to the program, and Tina, welcome to Quincy.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, great to have you both here. Really appreciate it. You know, Tina, I've heard of the program. Just kind of in passing, I guess, you know, I've seen maybe a couple of news stories in the local channels about organizations getting together and getting into a gymnasium at a high school or something and building a bunch of beds. And that's kind of the last I ever heard of it. I didn't realize it was an ongoing effort. Mm-hmm. So if you could tell me a little bit about the organization first.
Absolutely. So the Bed for Every Child program sets out to provide brand new beds to children living in poverty across Massachusetts. We are very fortunate to be able to provide beds for children in 93 different communities. And as we try to strengthen our presence in other communities, we look for supporters. So we're happy to partner with Quincy Credit Union in what we call our Build-A-Bed project, which was created to help sustain the 240 or about 240 referrals a month we receive for beds for children in need all across Massachusetts.
How did it all get started, Tina? Because it's relatively new, right?
It is, yeah. In 2012, this program was created as an initiative of the Massachusetts Coalition for the Homeless to provide a bed for a child in the Lynn community. A teacher reached out to us asking for a bed after discovering the child had recently started to live with their grandmother. And the grandmother had a fixed income, just couldn't stretch the dollar far enough to provide a brand new bed for this child. And so we were able and very lucky to be able to provide that bed for a kid, but it made us think a little bit more about poverty and children living in poverty and what else is missing, what necessities are not being addressed, whether within the community or a community service program, mm-hmm. whatever it may be. And so the Bed for Every Child was launched, and since 2012, we've served over 7,000 children.
That's incredible. Yeah. You know, it must have been kind of a hidden problem, I guess, because these are folks who are not homeless, right? Mm-hmm. They have homes, they're working, but they're the working poor, really.
I think that when we talk about children living in poverty, the first few things that come to mind are clothes and food insecurities.
The basics, right?
The basics, exactly. But what we fail to recognize is as the world continues to get more and more expensive to live in, mm-hmm. And wages kind of continue to stay stagnant, families are stretching their dollar further and further to keep a roof over their head, to keep a food on the table, to dress their children appropriately throughout the weather seasons in Massachusetts, but a bed. And often we have families that are sleeping with their children in the same bed, siblings sleeping in the same beds, children sleeping on floors, and natural disasters taking away a bed that they once had, whatever it may be. And so we're really happy to be able to say, you need a bed, you refer through a public school or a community service program, healthcare institution, whatever it may be, and we're able to get that bed free of charge and, of course, delivered too.
Right, it's something you just take for granted, you don't even think about, right? Mm-hmm. So we actually build them, though, right? These are handmade beds.
These are handmade beds. Yeah. They're not perfect beds, but they are beds that are built with love. And we say that left and right. And as we continue to have these community build-a-beds with corporations, we are so grateful to be able to continue to build beds. Just last week, we were able to build 100 beds, which was a milestone for us for children in need. And they are built, they are prepared from us at the Coalition or at the Bed for Every Child program, and then we create stations and bundles, and you see this pile of wood in front of you with all these tools, and it could be a little overwhelming, but once you get into the thick of it and you go through and you build these beds, it's fascinating to see the product that you provide, and they are well built and incredibly good beds. Yeah. Better than the bed I have at home.
Yeah, I was just going to say, it probably is better.
They are nice, good material.
Last them a lifetime, you know.
We hope so. It's the gift that keeps on giving.
Right.
And a good night's sleep is critical for anyone to perform well. Let alone a young child that needs the education the most.
Sure. So, Amy, how did Quincy Credit Union and, Build-A-Bed come together?
So, at the Credit Union, we've been involved in the community for over 80 years.
Right,
And as a credit union, we've been a part of the Cooperative Credit Union Association of Massachusetts, as long as I can remember, as long as we've been around. Mm. And the Mass Coalition for the Homeless is actually the preferred nonprofit for the Cooperative Credit Union Association.
Oh, okay.
So about, last year or so, it kind of came across my desk and, for options and things to kind of work for and work towards, and it kind of sparked my interest. That they were having Tuck, which is, kind of a mascot for homeless or children without beds or things. So I took him into the credit union last year.
Wait, what is Tuck?
Tuck is a 7-foot-tall Vermont teddy bear stuffed full and he is our mascot, and he travels around with a bed of his own and a book that talks about children living in poverty without beds and the importance of a good night's sleep.
So
he's a head turner. He definitely gets the attention of little ones, but also adults, and we're really happy to kind of use something that's welcoming and fun to address such a serious need.
Okay, all right. Sorry to interrupt.
No, absolutely. So tuck is important, but that's kind of how we kind of kicked off the connection and the relationship that we have now with Build-A-Bed and this coming to the community.
Yeah.
But Tuck was, you know, kind of my best friend for about a month last year. I actually took him to the police station. I took him to the fire department. I took him everywhere to help, one, raise awareness, and two, to help raise money via a social media campaign where people were sharing, liking, and trying to spark some interest and understanding of the issues that surround homelessness and poverty with children, specifically with this not-for-profit and the Mass Coalition for Homeless.
Okay.
So I started that, and this year, you know, naturally, we had already built a relationship last year. They reached out and said, this is something we're doing. Would you be interested? And we're like, absolutely. We'd love to have this. We have a huge presence in the community, and we have for a long time. And you know, one of the greatest things about Quincy is that everybody kind of helps out. We have so many resources left and right to help, but the awareness is one of the biggest things that is the problem, you know, not knowing. And that's why, you know, it's great to have QATV, who does all the specials on the things that happen, because I remember growing up, I grew up in North Quincy, went to elementary school, middle school, and high school, and there were some times where I'd go over friends' houses, and I'm like, wait, where does she sleep?
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
Like, so, or we don't go over certain friends' houses because for whatever reason, they're like,
they're embarrassed,
what?
Right?
Exactly. Yeah. And I mean, I just in this community know of so many different situations growing up where I didn't care. You know, it didn't bother me, but just the impression that has on that person, how they feel on day to day, going to school with all these other people of different poverty levels, middle class, some higher class, in Quincy we have it all. So I've definitely seen this firsthand. So being able to give back, build the beds, get them in our communities, because the beds that we are actually building are going specifically in the South Shore community.
Okay.
So we're giving right back here, and I think that's really important. And I think the awareness for this kind of needs to be brought to light a little bit more, and if we can help do that, that's what we want to do.
Yeah, like I had said, something that I just heard in passing, and said, that's, you know, it's a nice gesture, and let it go at that. But you know, 7,000 beds later, Tina, and still growing. So it's obviously you're trying to put yourself out of business. you know, you'd like to not have the need, right?
Right,
you'd
absolutely.
Like every child to have their own bed, but at the moment, that's not the case. How do you kind of determine who is in need? You know, how does that connection happen?
Well, most of our referrals come through our website, but the referring agency is typically a public school, and that's the constant in a child's life, or it should be at least the constant in every child's life, is their education, and a point of contact is a teacher, a familiar face you see every day. And so knowing that the education a child deserves is also an education that they're currently receiving. And so what we're trying to do is say, we're entering into a community as organically as possible, knowing that we can meet the need, meet the demand, and some of the most disenfranchised communities, they're the highest numbers of referrals that are coming through the doors, and they're coming from public schools, teachers, case managers, social workers in the school system.
Okay.
And we're thriving because of that, and we're able to get a bed right into a child's home that way. And surely enough, as socio detriments from poverty, from health and physical, anything that you can imagine, healthcare institutions, and of course having a 35-year-old agency, the Massachusetts Coalition for the Homeless, as our mother agency, we're able to have a reputation with other nonprofits in the community to be able to access our program.
How big of a problem is it in Quincy, Tina? Do you know specifically about how many kids are in need of a bed in Quincy?
I don't have those exact numbers, but I will say 1 in 7 children in Massachusetts are growing up in poverty.
Wow.
Not saying 1 in 7 children don't have beds, but as you can imagine, you know the world that we live in. You know how unaffordable it is to keep a roof over your head and food on the table with a family growing. If you're a single mother or a single father, a grandparent, a relative taking in a child, your income may already be spread as thin as it can be without jeopardizing your housing stability.
Yep.
And so we're really able and happy to be able to say, let's not jeopardize your stability by, you know, stretching your dollars to purchase a bed. Let us do this for you.
Yeah.
And I think that's why it's so imperative that we're continuing to grow, but as organically as possible, so we're able to meet that need. We're so happy to have Quincy Credit Union on our side by bringing the opportunity to provide 50 beds for 50 children living in poverty on the South Shore just on the 22nd at this community event. And so that's a start. And it's just the tip of the iceberg.
Okay.
If we're only in 93 communities in Massachusetts, that's just under a quarter.
Yeah.
How many more children are in need that we're not able to access?
Many, I'm sure.
Able
right?
to identify.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, as you mentioned, it's Saturday, June 22nd from 1 to 4, and it's going to be, Amy, at the credit union itself?
Yep, it's going to be at the credit union. We're going to be blocking off all the parking lot area.
Okay.
We're going to have some like music. It's going to be a great day. It'll be fun.
Okay.
And anybody that, you know, wants to stop by to even be hands-on volunteers or just to check it out and kind of understand how it works and the mission of the Build a Bed campaign in the community. They're more than welcome. So
who's building?
I'm building. a lot of people are building.
Really?
I know like the fire department has a team.
Okay.
I know the police. I know we all have teams, like a lot of the employees. And you guys, and they've reached out to Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts. There's a bunch of people that are going to come together from the community to help, and it's going to be so awesome.
This is an incredible cross-generational event. We have grandparents and their grandchildren, parents with their siblings, you know, their children or parents or siblings, aunts and uncles, community members, strangers coming together to build these beds. And it's really a wholesome experience, and we say it's a transformational project because the opportunity to take this built bed and deliver it into a child's home to really truly make a difference, it's something that's beyond words.
Do you ever hear back, Tina, from folks who've benefited from the program? Really?
We do, yeah, absolutely. And I think that's some of the best and most rewarding of not just being able to deliver these beds, but when someone comes and says, you know, this bed has made a true difference.
Yeah.
I mean, a house is a home when everyone is at their best.
Yeah.
And I think that being able to provide these beds for children is, you see it. You see that their attention span in school is better, maybe that their behavior improves, whatever it may be. I mean, anyone benefits from a good night's sleep, and we surely know the detriments of not receiving one.
And I bet they want to give back, too, to the organization, to the program, and say, let me help somebody else, you know, that you helped me.
Absolutely. We have a lot of people that always come back and say, how can I get involved and how can I continue to, you know, put the good word out? And I think that that's the power of being able to have a nonprofit with its open doors because, you know, if you're in need of a bed and you got one and you had a positive experience with us, you're not going to hesitate to say, hey, I know your son or daughter, or maybe that you are aware of someone in your community that may be in a tough spot, that may need a new bed of their own as well. And so we're happy to be able to have that relationship.
Well, say, you know, one of the recipients when the program first started 6 years ago, they were, I don't know, 7 years old. Today they're 13 years old, so they're able to...
It would be interesting to think back. I wasn't a part of the team back then, but it would be really interesting to kind of hear back from that family. Who knows? Maybe after seeing this, they'll come forward.
I hope so.
With a positive experience.
I hope so. I'm curious, where do the materials come from, and how is the delivery of the completed bed made? You know, how does that all work?
It is a very special process, that's for sure. So we're really able to, we buy a lot of wooden materials from local lumber companies such as Home Depot or Lowe's, really whichever is the best bang for our buck.
Sure,
and we're able to manufacture all the bed stations or the, you know, the bed building components here at our warehouse in Lynn,
the
Bed for Every Child program. We're able to work with the mattress wholesaler to get the mattresses out.
Oh, they get mattresses too?
Yeah, they get, it's a full kit. It's not just a bed frame. Mm-hmm. So every bed that's sponsored through a corporate sponsor or a donation is a bed frame, the wooden ones that are built by volunteers or sponsored volunteers, a mattress, bedding. If it's the beginning of the school year, they may get backpacks full of school supplies. If it's Christmas time or the holiday season, they may get a bag full of presents. It all really depends. As a nonprofit, it's really hard to determine what you have to be able to provide, but we really truly do our best to inform, you know, best inform families of sleeping habits, education with literature and books.
Oh, that's a huge benefit to a struggling family.
It's a whole bed. It's a whole kit and caboodle.
Fantastic. Yeah. So, Amy, you're encouraging folks, obviously, to check it out next Saturday, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely, yeah. So we're really excited for it. So the event is 1 to 4 at the credit union, and there should be plenty of parking, plenty of places for everybody to be. But even just for those that haven't already sponsored a bed or signed up in advance, just people to come check it out, see what the program's really all about, and just kind of be more aware. And I think that's the most important part.
Well, hopefully we helped get the word out a little bit this morning. Thank you both.
Yeah, thank you so much.
You're
thank
very
you very
welcome.
Much.
Just enough time to recap the forecast for you for the rest of the day today. Partly sunny, breezy, mild in the mid-70s this afternoon. Nice night coming up tonight. Should be starlit, actually, with lows down into the lower 60s. Tomorrow is definitely the pick of the weekend. Wall-to-wall sunshine, summer-like temperatures, low humidity. Maybe an unsettled day on Father's Day, but you still should be good. Round of golf in, no problem, Dad. And then showers and storms here on Monday as well. Thanks again to Amy Kelly and Tina Baptista for joining us today on the program.
Thank you so much.
Thanks to our crew. Thank you for watching. Monday at 11:30, Sheila Wilson's here from Stop Healthcare Violence on another live edition of Currently in Quincy. We will see you then.